Hi, this is our last lecture for today. Afterwards, we're going to go home and hopefully come tomorrow again when our friend Bojo will be opening. And now, please welcome Dipesh, who is a contributor from Mozilla and also lover of new and emerging technologies, and he's going to talk to us about one of those. Give him a welcome, please.
Hi, hello. So, am I audible? Yeah, okay. So, with the advent of Internet of Things, you can control your TV, monitor, fridge, washing machine, and it's become a child's play. You can control it from everywhere, but we are uploading our lives on internet, and now, is it really safe there? So, with the emerging technologies, your data is already being tracked, and now you are uploading your physical entities, your personal life, how you work, how you sleep on internet. So it's a really big question. And hi everyone, my name is Dipesh. I'm a Mozilla Tech speaker. I'm a research associate at IIT Indore, India, where I work on IoT-based system on chips. And I love emerging technologies and love to speak about on that. So let's define Internet of Things. So according to Wikipedia and Oxford, these are the definitions that are given for IoT. And my personal favorite is IoT is the interface between physical and digital world that allows us to collect information from and control everyday objects. So just a second. So, but it's increasingly clear that what called Internet of Things is the same old automation and the machine-to-machine technologies that has been around us from a decade or more. Most of the rest is a set of automation technologies that are making our life easier. So, is there IoT there, or it has been already in our lives, but we didn't knew that it is existing? So, a highly connected world where devices of all sorts intelligently use sensor data to do our things and makes our lives simpler is the aim of IoT that was thought of. So, IoT can be Internet of Things examples can found everywhere, starting from our body. There are a lot of devices such as insulin pumps that inject the proper amount of insulin if your sugar level changes. So those are Wi-Fi enabled, and they, if there's some abnormality, they send your data to your doctors. And there are other devices like the Fitbit can track your pace, your heartbeat. And in your home, there are various examples of IoT devices, the Nest, IoT-enabled thermostat. And you can remotely monitor and manage your home. There are IP cameras also there. And in your cities, there are various examples of smart dustbin or a smart street lighting system that can be controlled over the internet and monitored there. And in industries also, like you have it has been already there in industries also. So these are the few examples. Your smartphone is a good example of Internet of Things. So you have a smartphone. There's a Wi-Fi there. There's a Bluetooth there. And you have your GPS there. So it can track where you go. And there's a proximity sensor that tells you how you're holding your device. And it's all connected to the cloud. So it has been everywhere around us, but we haven't considered like it, it's existing. So dividing IoT into some few components. So Internet of things. We have first hardware, the tiny pieces, the bits that give us the information. So this is a ultrasonic sensor that beams the distance. So if I put this in my door, gate door, so it will start beaming information. Is the door open? When was the door open? And using this microcontroller, it can communicate with this. And it's only around $1. So these solutions are very cheap. And they are literally not using any cost. And the power that they run on is very less. For example, this embed chip, it runs for a year on this cell battery. So it has been pretty cheap and easy to find the hardware nowadays. And then is the data, the tiny bits and pieces that the devices, the machines communicate to. Data is the new, you can say, data is the new language. Data is the language that machines understand. It's not English. Machine doesn't understand English or Bulgarian or Chinese, but they understand data. Machines communicate with each other in form of data. And then you have the software, the fancy user interface that interprets what the data is and displays to the user. And next, we have the connectivity. With the advanced technology we use, coming by, we have 2G, 3G, 4G, and a recent technology that I have been working on, light fidelity, that is the transfer of data using light. So going on to more detail, there are a number of sensors available that can sense from smoke, humidity, temperature, fire, infrared rays, everything. And for example, this is a air quality monitoring sensor. So it tells if there is any methane present in the air, or if there's some gas leakage or anything. And there are various sensors available. And the data is the new oil, as said by Cisco. So every machine feeds on the data nowadays. So it has become the new oil for machines and devices. And the software, as I've already told you, and the devices such as this small chip, which is size of a thumb, less than a thumb also, and you can start beaming the information over Wi-Fi, and it's the same come for NRF, and that is also a very small device. So it has become very accessible and easy for everyone. So now we have got the brief idea about how things work and the major concerns. So let us now discuss the danger of uploading our physical lives on the internet. So privacy is paramount. Hey, I don't mind if my thermostat knows that I'm coming in my house, but it better not share this information with anyone. So, and I completely trust my bank for doing my online transaction, but can I trust my thermostat? I don't know what securities they are using, what encryption technology they are. I don't have any idea. I'm just getting the ease of access, so I'm using it. And now it has been everywhere. What if someone breaches into your network and access the personal information? And our ability to collect the data overwhelms the capacity to protect it. So that's what are the concerns of Internet of Things. Privacy. So they can get an access to our purchasing patterns, our access codes, our driving habits, where we are, how we are driving, have we stopped, are we in the car or not. So they can get the real time location about our how and when. And so recent study shows that the 70% of vehicles have wireless connectivity and are inadequately secure, insecure, and vulnerable. So some vehicles can even be hacked by SMSs. So even one vulnerable device that can provide an access to your whole network, and your whole home can be exploited using one. For example, a car has more than 70 to 80 computational system. It has GPS, diagnostic devices, remote locks, infotainment system, and it's all connected to your smart home. There's a smart garage opener that knows when your car is there. So if even one tiny bit is exploited in the whole ecosystem, the whole ecosystem can be compromised. So now these are running on 100 million lines of code, your home, your cars, and everything. So what if, think of a future, like we think of a future when the attacks increase and your home doesn't let you in. Or maybe you installed a vulnerable smart lock and someone cracked into it and you are not allowed into your home because of that, just because you didn't know what privacy and security it was using. And what if we think of a future when we are forced to buy a firewall for your toaster just because you want to make toast? So now talking about the vulnerability in the IoT ecosystem. So we, from the hardware point of view, these are the four components that have already discussed. So from the hardware point of view, we can access the hardware. So if we have the hardware, the physical device, we can exploit it. We can connect its debug port to our to our computer and devices, and we can get the shell access, and we can also get the review config of the devices. I'll give you the more detailed idea in a few minutes. And these are hardware are the black boxes that we don't know how they work, but if we get the access to the physical device, so they can be exploited very easily. And software are very easy targets. We don't know what we should do before installing the software for IoT is check the permission, whether it's using the privileges, whether that is required or any other privileges more than that. And it's the black box to user. The user doesn't know what happens inside the software. The software just takes the tiny bits of data and just give it to the, shows it to the user. So now, moving on to next is the data. So the data that goes into the device, is it relevant to the user? So the user can, if get into the hardware and read the data, then it is of no secure, it is not secure and private. And is the data encrypted? And is the data easily accessible? Are there some hardware pins where I can put my debugging port and get access to my device? And the connectivity. So it's all in the wonderful cloud. Everything is going to the cloud. So we don't know, is the cloud that it is giving the data to is encrypted? Is it authenticated? And where is it storing the data? So now with these concerns, I think the devices should come with the packaging like they does on the cigarette packs. Like if you want to buy a toy, maybe then you are giving permission to buy a listening device that can be exploited and listen your child's conversation. Or maybe you can starve your cat just because there's no internet connectivity, or an intruder comes by and knows that you are using your smart toilet and then just simply does burglary. And so coming on to the attacks of IoT, so this can be divided into the physical, local, and remote attacks. According to the McAfee prediction, the attacks are going to ramp up in Internet of Things. So when I'm thinking like an attacker, we have got three different ways in which we can get the physical access, where you pretty much have to have the device in your hand. That is the physical attack, or the local attack where you need to be in the network of the device, or maybe a remote attack where you can access the device from the internet. So they are the priority wise, the hacker that looks for the more The more better way to attack is the remote, then the least priority is the physical, because you can't have the physical access of your device. And then is the local, maybe you want to mess up with your neighbor or to do like to exploit their smart things. And so this device called UART, this device is used to interact with the debug port on the board of the various embedded devices that are connected to internet. So it has one wire for the TX, the transmission, the one wire for reception, and one for the ground. And it works on various voltages according to the devices. So there's another thing called EMMC, the embedded multimedia card, that is just like a memory card embedded on a chip. So you can access the card using the nearby resistors. You can plug your device, plug your multimeter or logic analyzer, or maybe flash something into this EMMC card. And now taking the example of the exploitation, you can take the example of Epson Artisan 700 and 800 version. So when you open this device, there are four pins that you have to look for. So in this case, you can see these are the four pins you can access. And if you connect your UART with this, you can get the access to the root. And now you can run, reboot it, reset it, or show the current IP, or my favorite, run arbitrary shell command. So next is the LG Smart Refrigerator. It runs on Android 2.3. It controls ice, compressor, water, anything. And it has a Wi-Fi, USB, SD card. So it can be exploited using UART. When you connect the UART, these are the pins. And then the UART boots to and root console, and you have the root access. Or when you work with EMMC, so you can insert stock Android launcher and run apps on the smart TV display, which is here. I'll show the demo of that video that has been shown at DEF CON. So this device is my favorite, personal favorite, because it gets the data of your insulin pump and sends it to Merlin.net for the doctors to monitor. So I can access this device using UART and send the information to the doctor, whatever I want. So these are some physical attacks, like I'll show you video, actually. So yes. Excuse me, no videos. Video is not so in the demo I'll be showing how it works, how you can boot an Android to your smart TV, or how this Merlin can go into party mode, and so on. So the video is okay. It's all okay. Okay. So this is like it is connected to the UART, and the shells comes up, and you then have the root access, and you can run the commands you want. Okay. For the next device, we have. You can run the commands, and this is the smart TV that I've been talking about. So it boots when you turn it on. So it works on Android 2.3. So you can access the EMMC. You can make it boot from the launcher that it has already inside or the one you have installed. And so this is the launcher that it already comes with, the Android it already comes with. And so these and then when I open this launcher, I get Android 2.3. I can run, install apps, I can do anything I want from this. Okay. And so, yeah. You can run root and give commands to this smart TV. So next device is the STM Merlin. You can just plug in this pen drive, and it goes into like crazy party mode. So that's okay. Display, which
here? Which here? Could you please mirror the displays?
What?
Mirror the displays.
Okay. So, yeah. So pretty much we have covered the physical attacks that we can do, and this is like a local network attack that is pretty we have experimented, and it was shown at a talk given at DEF CON by Brown and Latimer. And like if you you can access the devices if you are nearby, you can hijack the sessions and get the packets also. But like if you are not nearby, what we did was we took a drone and put a Raspberry Pi on that, and that ran Kali Linux, and then we made it roam around our college hostel, and we get the sessions of one connected to the Wi-Fi. And you can even put some RF modules and inject the keystrokes and monitor the activities. So there's a device called Key Sweeper. So you can make this easily using Arduino and a SIM module. So I have all the devices. This is a small Arduino and a Wi-Fi chip and some SIM module. So you can insert your SIM card here, and you can just assemble all this into a USB adapter, and maybe I can start gifting everyone these adapter. And then what it does is it gets your key strokes, the US that RF that 2.4 gigahertz it is using. So it gets the keystroke what you are typing, and start SMSing me what you are typing. So these are pretty much, and I can access your local net. If your one device is vulnerable, I can get access to the whole ecosystem, the whole connection that you have of your smart entities in your home. Now, coming to the remote session, if you have heard about Shodan, it's the scariest IoT search engine. I'll also give you a demo of that later on. So it basically, what it does is it search for the devices connected to the internet, your TV, your smart home automation system, the console, the webcams, and it displays, it gives a list. So now let us do like search for a routing network adapter or maybe a webcam. I'll show how you can do this. So it's pretty easy. You have to just type what you want to look for. It gives the list of the vulnerable devices, the IP address. So now you can refine also the country. There are various refines available. Now you can also filter the city, the geolocation, the OS, the port you want to access. And we searched for Honeywell building network adapters. So these are some adapters that are used for industrial grade routers. And you search for the, you type this name in it, Google insists for the password, like what is the root password. And there's a PDF available on the website. You open the website and you read the PDF, and yeah, there's no password. So okay, so now I come back to this website, and now I give type root, and I have the access to this whole router. I can reboot it or do anything I want. So there are even power meters available on the cloud, the web, that are not secure, because while installing these, we care about only the work it does. It is making our life simpler. That's it. We don't have any concern about the privacy and security issues. So there's also a map view in this Shodan engine. You can search which country are the devices, which industrial grade devices are there, and filter it by country, and it displays a very intuitive map. So its potential targets are routers, webcams, traffic lights, and pretty much there's a long list. So these are some images that I got from the webcams, the open webcams. So you definitely not want your life to be uploaded on the net and someone watching you, or a group people watching, or a search engine displaying what you're doing. And so there was a device called, there was a toy, not device, so called Hello Barbie. So what it does, it was an interactive toy for kids that was connected to Wi-Fi. And you can have a conversation, that your child can have a conversation, and it used to get the access to the internet from a Wi-Fi. And it was recently shown that this can be exploited. Your child's recording can be heard. And also there's a insulin pump that is Wi-Fi controlled, and I can control the amount of insulin I pump into your body. So maybe if I pump the amount which is more than the desired, maybe you might be dead or something. So even the devices such as egg crates, IoT-enabled egg crates are there. So that shows when you have placed an egg or when you have eaten an egg, at what time, the time snow. And since we are being watched, so maybe in future, it's tracking what you are buying. And like what we do now, what happens now is when we search for we search for shopping of a bag, and Google starts giving ads. So what if my TV is on the internet, and if I am running out of eggs, suddenly I get ads related to buying eggs or something like that. And maybe in future, if maybe the IoT devices can deny you the service, like your car is being updated, please wait, or so your smartwatch has been hacked. So I'll give you demo. Just a second. No, it works. Okay. It has turned off, I guess. It went into sleep mode.
I went to sleep because of power.
I don't know. Maybe you can reset. So, meanwhile, so you can easily access the Shodan web engine, and you can find all sort of devices that are connected on the internet on that. So, okay. So till then, I'll maybe if you want the details about the hardware, like how you can create a key sweeper or their devices, like how we did the Wi-Fi hacks, you can meet me after this session, and we can have a question if you have any questions or how it is done. So, okay. I just wanted to show this. It's not. This first project. Okay. So about the drone hijack I told you about. So this was shown at DEF CON. So I have a vulnerable mouse, and I go for a coffee, and then a drone comes by, and I can inject keystroke and exploit laptops and everything. So, and now I'll give you a demo about Shodan. So this is pretty much the search engine for Internet of Things, search engine for security stuff. And now I can just type a company name, or maybe, okay. So it displays the webcam. So you can search from company names also. So these are some webcams. This your cams are easily exploitable. And maybe I open a few webcam links, and I can get the access. So see, too many viewers. So already too many viewers are watching this feed. So. So it's a webcam, I guess there's night there. And like there's a lot of options to refine the country, the geolocation and everything. So it's just a one way to get access to your remote devices, but there are many other ways. It's just a few examples that I've covered. So now it's up to you to whether to use IoT devices or do some background research, what technologies they are using, are they secure or not, or just use for the sake of convenience. So that's it, I guess. Okay, I'll be sharing this presentation. So if you, I have commented also there, so the links and everything. So if you want the, okay, so You can mail me or DM me on Twitter. So, okay, that's it. Thank you.
We have some time for a couple of questions, if you have any.
Do you know any big company that's producing Internet of Things devices that's taking good care of its security?
So far, if they can be exploited in many ways. So even if it's secure, you can get access to the hardware and exploit it or something. So till now, I don't have any much idea about the company. So, yeah. Any other question? There's some line left. So,
okay. In that case, let's thank Dipesh.
Okay.